None of them woke up one morning and said, this is going to be my style. I think all of the people we're going to discuss are not just amazing visual stylists, they're also very, very clever strategists.
Hey, welcome to Indie Mogul. My name is Ted, and today we're here with production designer Guy Hendrix Dyas, who is one of my favorite production designers out there. He's worked with just about any director you can think of. Seriously, name one, and he's done it. He's worked with people like Christopher Nolan, to people like Steven Spielberg, to people like Ang Lee. And today what we're going to be talking about is we're going to be talking about directorial style. Specifically, what does it mean for a filmmaker to have style? What separates good style from great style? And then finally, we're actually going to watch some clips and some movies from some of the most famous directors of all time. And we're going to break into what is Guy actually seeing from each of these directors, and what are some things that you can actually try to emulate yourself. All right, so to kick things off, what does it mean for a director to have style, in your opinion?
Okay, so visual style is a really important part of any director's sort of process. And each of the directors we're going to talk about today, they've developed these awesome visual styles that really are trademarks, if you like, of their own personal stamp on a film project. And this can be anything from the way they choose to work with their production designer, what the way they choose, for example, their composer, the way they choose to work with their DP. All of these people who are around them, who help them craft these films, they have tendencies to lean on one or two of those particular positions more heavily than others. I think all of the people we're going to discuss are not just amazing visual stylists, they're also very, very clever strategists. They know when they're putting their film projects together where to spend the time, where to spend the money. It's about communicating a story at the end of the day.
I think, and I see you as one of the masters of production design, so I cannot think of someone better to go through and talk about visual style and directors today. So are you ready to watch some scenes?
Let's do it. This is, of course, one of the greatest directors of all time, Alfred Hitchcock. You could almost say that Alfred Hitchcock sort of has a voyeuristic style. I mean, look at the lengths he's going to show us these insane details. This will develop into an eye, for example, when she grabs the shower curtain. I mean, he was very well known for working out quite rigid storyboards as well. Of course, famously, he had to build the exterior of the house. That house was actually based on a painting, I believe, by Edward Hopper called The House by the Railroad. Edward Hopper has this wonderful sort of palette, which I would say relates very beautifully to Alfred Hitchcock films, perhaps. And again, let's talk about innovation here. Let's just make sure that everyone understands that Alfred Hitchcock is not some stuffy old British guy who made these boring films. I mean, look at what's going on here. This is literally challenging Walt Disney. Now, you know, in terms of being able to just expand into animation here, I think particularly with Vertigo, there was an experimentation, as we can see here, with color, particularly surrounding this sort of emerald green and the use of red, particularly around the actress. You know, there's a sort of a mistaken identity situation. I don't want to ruin the plot for anyone who hasn't seen this.
To some degree, he laid a lot of a foundation that other directors look to and draw from.
So. He did. It's hard to think about it now because we're so far in the future from when these films were made. But they were also cutting edge. They were cutting edge in the way David Fincher's films are. Cutting edge. He, I think, was one of the people who came up with the dolly zoom. And I think in the film Rope, he wanted it to appear to be a single take. They really were very new and groundbreaking. This, of course, is the master himself, Steven Spielberg. What can you say about this director? There's so much to say. I think Steven Spielberg wears many, many hats here. We talk about his visual style. He's a man who can direct a film through a child's eyes. He can deal with with complex and sensitive social and political issues. He really can challenge every genre of filmmaking there is. And I think that's one of his skills as a filmmaker, which is to tell really fantastical stories in the most everyday setting that you can imagine. For those that don't know this, Steven is a big collector of Norman Rockwell paintings and art. But in many ways, if you think about that just for a minute, it doesn't apply to all of his work, but Norman Rockwell captures that wonderfully warm and charming part of Americana and American life that is something that I get very strongly when I look at many of Steven's films. You're able to relate to his characters so easily, and that is part of his directorial style. Even a film like Jaws, there are very important key scenes that involve children and children's perspective on the situation that's happening. You know, Chief Brody, the main character and protagonist in Jaws, we get to see all of his flaws and weaknesses and things that make him very human. And I think this is something that a lot of filmmakers pre-70s didn't do because movie stars were movie stars. You know, you had to show them as these sort of perfect beings. I think everyone at some point has borrowed or been inspired by Steven. I mean, his films are the ultimate blueprint of how to tell a story through moving image. He's able to find those magic moments. We are watching the wonderful Kathryn Bigelow. She really started to look at these characters and use all the skills of creating these high-pressure situations and turning it into this sort of docudrama style that is uniquely hers. A great use of the Steadicam with Kathryn's work, and that's something we see a lot of with these films that helps, I think, promote that idea that this is happening at that moment. We're right there with the character. But I think also the thing that's really interesting about the way her work has developed, and I think it comes through in her directorial technique here, is that she really doesn't force feed you the idea that this person is either good or bad. I think she really lets you decide as the audience whether you think this person is a good character or a bad character, you know? There's never any judgment, you know? Even in this scene here where we're looking at a soldier getting paranoid because he's being recorded by one of the locals and he's telling them to stand down and they just won't. And things that I've read about with Kathryn is that she's incredibly well-researched. She does not enter these situations half-cocked. She knows her subject, she knows the history, surrounds herself with advisors. And I think a lot of that realism comes across in her work as well. I'm seeing and thinking about National Geographic and how that not just gives us these incredibly insightful photographs, but also all the information that comes along with those photographs, the maps, the breakdowns, the charts, the analyzing of these real life events, and sometimes very uncomfortable things, whatever it is. She's not frightened to dive right in there as a filmmaker and talk about those things and tell those stories. She is not frightened to put herself in these extreme situations of heat and hardship, which I'm sure as an artist, she sort of, I think, makes her films with great emotion. And that's probably helped by putting herself in locations and situations where she herself is uncomfortable as a filmmaker. You know, a lot of films about war and politics and all the things that go into modern day life have been made. But I think Kathryn Bigelow's are this sort of wonderful balance of this sort of docudrama style with gritty
and realism. Now, before we talk about our last director, I want to give a shout out to Hurlbutt Academy, who is, yes, also going to help you achieve your visual style. Now, so far, we've talked about a lot of things. We've talked about Steadicam shots, bold color palettes, and if you are a cinematographer, you are probably wondering, how do you use these techniques effectively in your department as well? So you can choose from over 400 different lessons from hurlbuttacademy.com, or you can dive into entire courses that walk you through more advanced concepts, whether it's lighting theory, camera movement, or even just the basics of cinematography. Now, all of this is taught by Shane Hurlbutt, ASC, who has over 30 years of cinematography experience shooting things like Act of Valor, Into the Badlands, and The Greatest Game Ever Played. In fact, he's one of the best people to learn from because he's done all of this, especially in the camera, especially in the lighting department, and he knows how to simplify everything. So learn from Shane himself by going to hurlbuttacademy.com and signing up for an annual membership of just $30 a month while getting 10% off by using the discount code IndieMogul at checkout. So thank you to Hurlbutt Academy for sponsoring this video, and now, back to the episode.
We're talking about the incredible Wes Anderson, of course. You know, we're seeing one of the things that we can straight away talk about with Wes, which is his love of symmetry. Now, we've talked about symmetry with a couple of other directors, but if there was somebody that absolutely loves the tableau of having symmetry. Look at this. Absolutely loves the symmetry of these things. The character in the center, these very, very strong one-point perspectives. But at the same time, they're not boring. There's a lot of incredible information here. You can see straight away Wes's love of all things visual, from the costumes to the design, the carefully balanced color that he goes into great detail. You know, his inspirations are also very broad and very European. You know, he likes, François Truffaut, Pedro Almodovar, but he also likes some of the quirky stuff from the US directors. Hal Ashby's Harold and Maude, I hear, is one of his favorite films. And when you totally hear that. You can absolutely imagine it. Of course, Hal Ashby, I think, also did Being There, another slightly strange study on a character in Peter Sellers. So you immediately start to paint a picture of who Wes is. I think his themes are very clear. They're usually sort of family-driven, dysfunctional families, perhaps. There's also this wonderful childlike loss of innocence that always seems to happen in his films. You know, it's sense of humor with tragedy, all in one go. This is amazing. This is one of my favorite Wes Anderson films, of course. The Life Aquatic. This is one of the other things that he's extremely well known for, which is this love of miniatures. It's like taking the front off a doll's house and looking inside. He works with an array of very talented production designers, but it's very clear that he is the master of his aesthetic. It doesn't matter really who he's working with. Costume designers, DPs, production designers, his films are going to look a specific way. They are going to look like Wes Anderson films. And I think he has an absolute fascination with popular culture. And you can see that he sort of, I suppose he thematically arranges his scenes into specific decades. You know, you can look at the Royal Tenenbaums and it's all clothes from the late 70s. I mean, I'm old, I was around then, so I remember all that. Yeah. But it's done very, very accurately. And then you can see here, you know, the Fantastic Mr. Fox, his costume literally looks like someone who has an office job in the 1950s in America. His stories are strong enough and funny enough and tragic enough that he can hold people's attention while presenting them with these incredibly distracting worlds. Because, and when I say distracting, I mean distracting in the best possible way. I mean, every single frame is a work of art. It's stunning.
For people out there that are trying to develop and find their own style, what would you recommend?
None of them woke up one morning and said, this is going to be my style. I think none of these styles are fake or developed through a desire to just have a style. I think they all worked very hard. I think they all made lots and lots of films, and I think they naturally found their style. And I think that's true of all filmmakers. All of these amazing filmmakers have had many years and many successes and sometimes failures. And those are the ways that they've been able to say, okay, this works, this doesn't work. It's really as simple as that.
Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Oh, as always.
Alrighty guys, there you have it. There's your episode on directorial style with Guy Hendrix Dyas. If you haven't seen it already, we did an episode with Guy where we actually walked through three of the films that he production designed, and we talk about what are the challenges that went into designing films such as Steve Jobs, Inception, Elizabeth, The Golden Age. You should seriously watch it if you haven't seen it already. It's one of our favorite episodes ever. Also, moving on from that, if you liked this episode, we actually have another episode coming out soon where we talk about four more directors. We do the same thing that we went over today, but we're going to break down four more of the most famous directors of all time. If you want to check them out, check out that video as well. Again, thank you to Hurlbutt Academy for sponsoring this video. Start building out your visual style by going to hurlbuttacademy.com and using the code IndieMogul for 10% off of an annual membership. Other than that, my name is Ted. Thank you so much for watching Indie Mogul. And of course, we'll catch you guys in the next one.
Total and utter commitment. I can personally relate to it because I'm like that about my own design work, as my crew remind me every day. But for Wes, yeah, oh yeah, they get very But for it. Wes, this is his world. So it's really important to have those levels of detail. Mm.